We have with us Mr. Arkadeb Chakraborty, who's going to share with us a little on the recruitment perspective on the FMCG industry. He's currently the DGM at Godrej Consumer Products. Thanks, Arkadeb. So, give us a little understanding of how or what is the recruitment scenario right now in the FMCG industry.
So, I think FMCG industry recruitment scenario obviously remains almost the same. I mean, okay. there hasn't been such a large impact as such that has changed because of COVID or the pandemic, or right. so to say. It is mostly the same. In fact, initially the kind of natural attrition that you would see, mm-hmm. that had reduced because people were not very willing to shift jobs during the pandemic and right. all of that. But now things are getting back to normal. So okay. it's the same kind of churn that we are seeing. Just because it is happening after some time, so there is a feeling that it's increased suddenly. Right. But if you right. look at overall 4 to 5 years trend, the same pattern is coming back.
Okay. So during the pandemic, was it any different? How did things change?
In terms of recruitment or the ways of working?
The ways of working.
Okay. So I think the ways of working, there was a lot of I think evolving that organizations and adaptation that organization right. did, right? So they. Right. And for us also that was the case because it happened in phases, right? Okay. So in March 2020 when it all started, mm-hmm. Initially it was more of a supply chain problem. Mm-hmm. Then the entire focus was there is this entire pandemic which has come, mm-hmm. and there is lockdown which is happening, right. and how do we do sales,
right?
But the demand has suddenly shot up, right? Because of the lockdown, people started buying and all of that.
So in fact, buying more
and right. to that extent, trying to hold.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And then that it's not a problem of selling anymore because anyways, people want to buy.
Yeah.
The problem then was how do I connect my stock to the last mile, right. to the consumer, right?
Right.
And I think that's where people wore different hats. So the entire organization came together, mm-hmm. getting permissions, you being an essential service provider, right. getting those permissions. So the salesperson on the field, mm-hmm. for the first time in his life, forgot sales and became a logistics person.
Okay.
He was running after getting these permissions and ensuring that the tempo reaches the shop. Because right. if you can connect your stock, it will sell.
Correct.
And more than selling and getting revenue, it is also that large part of I need to do this for the country because I need to provide
True.
These essential materials to the consumer.
True.
So I think the first phase was all about that, and then they emerged as real heroes, the manufacturing yeah. People in the factories and people on the ground, mm-hmm. who were then working tirelessly and risking their own lives to get these things done.
Right.
And from a management perspective, in one day, people were absolutely fine that a salesperson is not going to the market. I think that was one big paradigm shift that we all True. Got, we all accepted. Right. So I think that was the first phase that happened. Mm-hmm. After that, as lockdown happened and things started returning a little bit back to normal,
right.
it was then answering this entire, I think, this entire tension that people had in their mind, mm-hmm. right? How to take care of myself? Should I go back to work? Should right. I start visiting the market? If I visit the market, am I risking my family? Mm-hmm. What if something happens to me? Who is going to bear that cost?
Correct. Right? Correct.
And I think that's where a lot of solutioning organizations had provided,
right.
Providing them with adequate information. Mm-hmm. Credible information so that it's not about rumors and all of that. It's credible information coming from a good source.
Right.
Providing them with the right kind of apparatus, which is masks, sanitizers, mm-hmm. so that they can take care of themselves. And then topping it up with a lot of healthcare insurances, a lot of assurances that, we would take care of the cost, we would take right. care of if anything happens. And the entire organization providing these support groups right. which came together and ensured that even if somebody is affected, all kind of help reaches that person very fast.
Okay.
So that gave a lot of confidence to people on the ground.
True.
And even if we were not telling them to go to the field, they were genuinely wanting to do their work and, you know, also because they know now that they are protected. Anything happens, they would be taken care of.
Right. So you got the fear out.
We got the fear out to a large extent. We cannot take it out 100%.
Right.
And as a government is doing, state governments are doing, central government is doing their bit.
Right.
But as organizations, we also stepped up. Not only my organization, but many other organizations.
True.
They stepped up and created this entire, I think, sphere of protection, safety, care around employees, especially on the ground level,
right.
which was very, very required at that point of time. So that was probably the second phase,
right.
which that's how we adapted to it.
So you mentioned how, you know, in the first wave, organizations adapted to changes and everything. The sales guy becoming a logistics guy. And then the second wave you just spoke of. What happened later on, after that? Now, what is the state of things?
So, I think the situation has been evolving. So, there was a first wave. It kind of tapered down and we were all in our good humor saying that it's all coming to an end.
Right.
And suddenly, bam, the second wave comes, right? And it again starts this fear. And the second wave was pretty, pretty drastic to that extent, right?
Yes.
Luckily, people had the learnings from the first wave.
True.
So we didn't have to go back to the drawing board again with supply chain and all of that because those things were now sorting out. Governments had also realized how to handle in case of a lockdown, so on and so. And for the employees, I think there are two aspects which as an organization we did.
Mm-hmm.
And one was addressing their well-being.
Right.
Because this entire thing from March 2020 till say about March 2021, that entire 1 year,
mm-hmm.
working from home, meetings, lack of physical connect,
right,
really took its toll on people.
Absolutely.
Right? And it was, and that's when people started missing office.
Yeah.
Right. So the way we've kind of answered that problem by taking out different measures and trying to understand, having a lot of surveys with people to understand what's the mood, what is it that they're kind of really, really concerned about, right?
Mm-hmm.
So there was a bouquet of things or you know, measures that we took.
Right.
One was obviously to give this breaks in between. We became more serious about that.
Mm-hmm.
Forced, you know, one entire day, entire organization declared leave so that people can get a long weekend.
Okay.
And they were advised to spend that time with their family.
Right.
Because people were, you know, there was burnout and all of that was happening.
Yeah, because I think the whole concept of time was eroded.
Yeah.
Because you started work and you went on to it.
Correct. So it all started and, you know, we all thought that, oh, we are now cutting down on travel. We don't have to go to office.
Yeah.
But little did we realize that when you're at home, there are parallel things at home also happening.
True.
So you then start getting used to washing your dishes while you're having your meeting and all of that. And there is the boundary between stopping work and starting your family life slowly becomes a little
hazy.
It got merged, right?
Yeah.
And so we had to take our measures to remind people that take a leave, it's okay, spend some time with your family. We had to encourage people to shut down after, say, 7 o'clock, right?
Yeah.
Don't have meetings after that. We started tracking meetings after that and nudging people not to do that. And a large part of this entire experience was around meetings because that became the new devil that came, you know, meeting. And we also realized that there were so much of meetings happening, people were not getting time to do their own work.
Yeah.
You know, the deep work that anybody does. So we also kind of put one day, you know, Thursday first half as a no meeting time, that no meeting should be scheduled during this time. So that advisory was also given. And for sales, we had this entire 3E framework that we rolled out, which is about empathy, equilibrium, and efficiency.
Okay.
And that was a playbook that we rolled out saying that these are the three things we should keep in mind during these times, right?
Right.
First, be empathetic towards the other person. It's okay if a pressure cooker goes off.
Hmm.
It's okay if the if your children are suddenly coming in between a meeting. We should all be
accommodative
of that. True. Right.
True.
The second part was all about efficiency. How much of meetings do we call? When do we call? How much, you know, a meeting, is it requires to be 2 to 3 hours, or it can be done in half an hour? Can you send three reads before so that decision can be taken, right?
Mm-hmm.
All these guidelines were provided. And the last one was about equilibrium, which is how do you cut off?
Okay.
How do you maintain that equilibrium between your life and work, right? And along with that, the other thing that we did was about mental well-being. Right. So sessions on mental well-being, how to look at those small symptoms where you can see that your team member is getting worked up or is getting burnt out, right? How to be proactively taking care of that. So all this was done. So that was one part of it which took care of their well-being.
Right.
And the second part is our learning that the entire country had, that there is only one way to now defeat this pandemic, and that is vaccination.
Right.
So I think we went all out in terms of providing that support to all employees and extended workforce, saying that we will take care of your vaccination.
Okay.
So, and that was a huge initiative that the organization and in the front HR and the admin departments took in creating that framework and that infrastructure to provide vaccine to each and every employee.
True. So when you say extended workforce, who did you include in that?
So extended workforce would be our distributor salesmen,
okay.
Anybody who is not part of our roles but still working for us in some way or the other.
Right, indirectly. Or
indirectly also. So because we have finally then, you know, kind of took care of that part also.
True, that speaks volumes, you know, of the organization itself.
Yeah.
Interesting. So, in all of this during the pandemic, organizations such as yours, I mean, you've come forward, you know, you've taken initiative, mental well-being, helping the guys out, right, you know, from people who are connected to you or indirectly connected to you. What change did you observe from the consumer's end? How did their behaviors change?
I think there was a lot of change in the way consumer started, behaving. Pre-COVID versus post-COVID.
Right.
I think one thing that really happened was the entire focus on hygiene products increased significantly.
Right.
So people's demand for anything which is connected to their hygiene, things like soap, sanitizers, these things really shot up. Right. And the entire FMCG industry responded to that by a lot of companies getting into that category, and we were also one of them that we got into that category and started, because there is a demand and we need to address that demand, because in this situation that is very important. So I think that is one, from a product demand perspective, that increased. The shopper behavior also increased, because now people were leaning more on e-commerce than always going to a kirana store. So the e-commerce business also, the demand started rising very sharply.
True.
So we had to adapt very quickly to ensure that, you know, all the stock connection with e-commerce is very, very well done, so that people can get that. So I think the from going to the local store to ordering on the e-commerce platform became a known thing after the pandemic. People started,
I think, it
using
became the obvious choice. There was no other choice.
Yeah. So it became the obvious choice. So I think these are the two areas in which the consumer changed their behavior patterns.
True. Again, bringing you back to a recruitment perspective here, is what do you think were the challenges? What do you think are the challenges that recruitment stakeholders are facing now in these times?
So I think a lot of it is about the pandemic has forced all stakeholders to change almost overnight.
Right.
So I used to remember a lot of people telling me, I am not very comfortable if I don't see the guy face to face or see the candidate face to face, right?
Yeah.
All that has changed. Now you have no option.
Yeah.
So I think the first thing is going digital, right?
True.
Not only with interview, but with the rest of the process.
True.
Whether it is interview feedback, whether it is scheduling, everything goes online, and I think that's one big change that has happened.
True.
And to support that, the entire onboarding process, mm-hmm. that has also moved online. So now, okay. you know, you can get a job in Bombay, but organization is okay if you are in Baroda for 3 months till things right. open up. And right. till that 3 months, everything is, you manage, you work from home, and that adapting to that style and whatever it takes, onboarding and inducting a person
right.
Non-physically and digitally,
so,
that becomes something that is very important.
True. Well, thank you, Arkadeb, again, for sharing your insights in this section.